Several even reported the vanishing phenomenon.
The bees go into a semi-hibernation state during the winter months, and it isn't until next spring that you find there are no bees at all in the colony. Absolutely none. Not a single bee.
They just disappeared.
Honeybees are extremely important to us all, and if we don't sort out the problems of honeybee disease in the next few years, it's quite possible that honeybees will disappear from the environment in the UK.
I mean, you open up a hive with no bees in it, you just stand there speechless.
When you go into an apple orchard and there's apples, take the bees away, no apples.
You have to remember that bees and plants have evolved together over 10, 20 million years in the environment, and that losing one must inevitably affect the efficiency and lifestyle of the other.
While British beekeepers marched on Parliament, back in the US, bees were continuing to die. Keepers were not only suffering vanishings, but also from the effects of the treatment-resistant varroa mite. There was a real anxiety that there wouldn't be enough bees to pollinate crops. So farmers turned to one of the few countries left where bees were thriving, Australia.
Okay, let's get started. We're shaking what we call shaking package bees, packing the bees from the hives into the packages we export them to into the US. First of all, we have to sort of get a lot of the bees from the bottom boxes and push them into the top box. Then we lift that box off and blow the bees out into shaker boxes. Then they are weighed out into funnels and then inverted into the packages that we actually export the bees in. And we can weigh them all exactly the right amount. 4 pounds of bees are going to the US with a queen bee, and 5 packages go in a rack.
Unlike every other developed country, Australian bees are flourishing, which means there are plenty of healthy bees available for export. Australia has so far avoided that scourge of bees everywhere, the varroa mite. But for how long?
If the mite was to arrive here in Australia, it would probably come in on, say, a European honeybee from another country, because all other countries have got the mite now. So if a bee was to arrive here on a boat, it could jump off the boat onto land and then start spreading and introduce the mite. If varroa got here, it would be devastating.
To protect their bees, Australian authorities are spending a fortune on biosecurity.
So we have what we call a port surveillance program in place. We have what we call sentinel hives. That's our number one defence.
Hives in strategic places like ports and airports are monitored on a 3-monthly basis.
We monitor those hives, so we put in chemicals and we check for mite levels, just in case a swarm hasn't come off a boat, landed on shore with mites on it. If varroa got here, we would have a shortage of bees, so things like exports would be out.
In the meantime, exporters like Terry Brown are making thousands of dollars exporting live bees. Packages are sealed securely so that no bees are left on the outside of the cases. Although the passengers are probably unaware of it, these packages of live bees are then placed in the hold of scheduled aircraft and flown for 14 hours to Los Angeles, where they can be sent off to the fields to pollinate in a foreign and potentially toxic environment. This is clearly an unsustainable way of propping up the planet's agricultural system, and would collapse overnight if Australia's bees began to display the problems of those in the rest of the world. While Australian bees were crossing the Pacific, scientists at the University of Sussex decided to tackle the matter by turning it on its head. Their thinking is simple. As well as focusing on finding the causes of deaths, they're attempting to breed bee colonies that are more resistant to disease.
What we're doing is we're taking our existing British race of the honeybee and we're finding which hives are hygienic and we're breeding from them. So we're breeding, you might say, an improved British bee.
Inside a hive, bees arrange themselves on a very strict hierarchy. The queen is the only bee that lays eggs. All the rest are divided into tasks, from the foragers who go out to collect food, to the bees that guard the entrance from intruders, to others whose job it is to keep the hive clean. And it's the efficiency of these bees that Professor Francis Ratnicks and his team are keen to exploit.
Hygienic bees control these brood diseases by removing any dead larva or pupa very soon after it gets sick. The idea is that one bad apple can spoil a whole barrel of apples. If the bees can remove them, then they can prevent the disease infecting the whole colony.
Since they all look rather similar, the trick is learning how to select the right bees. To do this, researchers take combs from hives and kill an area of the larval bees by freezing. The comb is photographed and returned to the hive. 48 hours later, researchers go back to see how many of the dead bees have been removed. Some hives are really good at clearing out the corpses, while others are less efficient. The cleaner the comb, the more hygienic the bee, and it's these that are selected for breeding.
We're not actually doing any genetic changes, but nevertheless we use some modern genetic methods, if you like, to tell which is the best mother or the best father to use in our breeding programme.
While the Sussex programme and others around the world use modern scientific techniques to accelerate and improve on traditional breeding methods, the research will still take time. Time in which bees are continuing to die. In America, after 3 years of astonishing vanishings, scientists are still unable to find a single definite culprit on which to blame the disorder colony collapse, or CCD. Pesticides may be playing a part, but most experts have concluded that there's a range of factors involved, from diseases to trucking to lack of varied food sources.
There's no one cause of CCD. There's nothing that, at least that we have been able to find by looking very hard, there's no one reason for this collapse.
What's clear is that colony collapse disorder isn't the only problem that bees are facing. In most parts of the world, they're battling varroa and a range of other diseases. Science may be learning more about bees, but so far, it's been unable to come up with effective solutions to keep them alive.
Here's a bee colony that can't live in the environment that we're giving them. And bees are out there sweeping the environment. That's what they do. And they come back in the colony, and the nest may be contaminated. And it may be full of mites, and then they get moved around, to pollinate crops. It's just too much. They are showing us directly what we're doing to the environment.
Bees act as a barometer for the general health of the planet. And I think if you've got one creature that's been so widespread across the planet, and suddenly it's coming under such an attack that they're almost being wiped out, we've got to be asking how that's feeding further up the food chain and right across nature.
While science scrambles for a definite answer to why bees are dying, there are things that we as individuals can do to help save our bees.
Most people don't have a lot of land, they just have a small garden. But if we took all the gardens across the whole of the country, it's a substantial area. So individuals can make a difference by making sure that their gardens have as many wildflowers, or they don't have to be wildflowers, they could be garden flowers, just so long as they provide something for wildlife.
I think if you've got land, make it available, and then maybe get 3-4 hives, or allow a young oncoming beekeeper to actually keep a few hives in your space. I think that's a good way of moving forward, and you'll get a few jars of honey out of it.
At last, we're finally realising just how much we depend on bees, just how much of human life, as we know it, wouldn't exist without the bees. And the only good thing I can see of coming out of this sort of terrible loss of honeybee colonies is that maybe we'll finally redress the balance a bit and feel a bit more gratitude to bees.
When I think of the problems facing bees and why they've been brought to the brink, I have to wonder whether they're the canary in the coal mine, an early warning about the state of our planet. It's clear that to help the bee, we have to think about the environment and ways that we can change our own behaviour. I know now, from bitter experience, how easily they can disappear.
This winter was absolutely terrible for my bees. When the hive was opened up in the spring, most of them were dead. That's the third time it's happened to me. And it's very distressing when you see thousands of these creatures that you've looked after throughout the year lying dead on the floor of the hive. I've decided I'm going to try and rebuild my colony, even though it's difficult, because it's so important that we try and boost the population of bees. This isn't simply about getting honey or beekeeping as a hobby. It's about protecting vital sources of food for all of us. We need to create an environment in which bees can survive, not just for now, but for generations to come. After all, a world which is kind to the honeybee has to be good for the rest of us too.